In a first for this channel, we are taking things back to the West, with the first American Juon. Hot off the heels of Juon 2, Takashi Shimizu decided it was the perfect opportunity to completely whore out the series he had so lovingly created. But, in all seriousness, many foreign directors and actors find it hard to break into the American film industry. And even when they do, they find it harder to find real success. Shimizu saw his chance, and he took it. Even if some of the movies that he made weren't so great, this was still his only chance to really break into the American film industry. Now, when reviewing remakes, there's a certain notion that you have to view it separately from the original. That to compare it to the original would be grossly subjective. I completely disagree. Why bother pretending one exists if you are ever going to talk about the other? For as long as The Grudge has existed, Juon has existed longer. Good remakes will rise above that hurdle of comparison. And if Juon is the hurdle that The Grudge has to jump over, then it better be a damn good movie. So how does Juon translate from Japanese to English? It doesn't, or at least not entirely. The Grudge still takes place in Japan and uses a few Japanese actors. Well, it uses one Japanese actor, kind of. And here we arrive at my first gripe. Why the fuck are there all these white people in Japan? We have a couple of exchange students, two different married couples, including one of the husband's sister and mother. And to top it all off, Ted Raimi's there, brother of Sam Raimi, the producer on The Grudge. You know, Evil Dead, Spider-Man. That's our main cast. There's a Japanese detective, but he's barely a character in this. He's kind of there by necessity. When most of your cast is white, why not just set it in America? At this point, you're already shitting on the original. Just go all the way. But there is an interesting dynamic that this brings up that wasn't in the original. The fear of being isolated in a foreign country. This is definitely a theme that can go hand in hand with the themes already present in Juon. And there are, in fact, a couple scenes where this is used and touched on and done well. But when your cast is full of whiteies, it's hard to get that feeling of foreign isolation across. And while that is an interesting way to look at it, there's unfortunately a bit of the, wow, isn't Japanese culture so weird?
It's a Buddhist ritual. The incense smoke carries the prayers to the spirits of their ancestors.
Which only comes across worse with a cast full of Westerners. If I had to guess, I would say perhaps Shimizu had a bit of help from producer Sam Raimi. Maybe enough to necessitate a co-director credit? It wouldn't be a surprise. It would even be understandable, considering this was probably the first time Shimizu ever worked with Westerners to such an extent. And while Shimizu himself is far from perfect, I wouldn't put it past Raimi to be responsible for some of the worse aspects of this movie. This is the first time where Juon has felt too pretty. Everyone has had their makeup done, their hair styled perfectly, all the houses look polished. There's no authenticity. The originals were raw. That's what made them more believable. The higher in budget that Juon goes, the worse it gets. But how is the story? Well, it's just Juon again. But this time there's white people instead of Japanese. There's little bits of the curse in it too, mostly to explain the backstory. The scenes that are carbon copies were done better in the originals. The scenes that aren't are by far the most cliched and the worst parts. The film drops the chapter titles for the most part, and this is by far their worst decision. They still keep the narrative that jumps around from place to place, time to time, but dropping the chapter titles makes the transitions from scene to scene horribly clunky. With a title card, we are mentally prepared to get reacquainted with the characters and setting. Instead, the film will just fade to black with no indication that we'll be following a different set of characters at a different point in time. This may seem like a small change, but it makes all the difference between a well-crafted tower and a mess of Jenga pieces. The curse had its audience piece things together. There was only one scene to explain Kayako's backstory, and that's mirrored in The Grudge. But this time around, the backstory is being told to our audience self-insert, instead of the audience making the connections themselves. It's all laid out for them. And as far as the cast goes, there's plenty of people I probably should recognize. But the only one that matters is Sarah Michelle Gellar. Maybe it's because I've seen Buffy grow from a high school student to a high school guidance counselor, but she feels too old for this role as a college exchange student. Not that she looks old, not that she even really is old, but she just feels too old for this. For the age that they're going for. At the end of the day, there are far worse transitions from Japanese media to American. On its own, it's a fairly average and forgettable horror movie. It's not, and never should be, a replacement for the original. Everything about The Grudge 2 is worse than everything that came before it. Just even outside of Ju-on, The Grudge 2 was a mistake. Just a mistake that we all made. Where to even begin? You might think that The Grudge 2 is a remake of Ju-on The Grudge 2, but once you start the movie, you'll see a scene ripped straight from Ju-on The Curse 2. This movie is not a remake. This movie is a wholly original piece of shit. The Grudge 2 drifts even further from its motherland by setting half the movie in America. Of course, the parts that do take place in Japan are centered around white actors, but that's not the issue. If anything, my complaints about the first movie and representation aren't even valid here. Instead, here's the biggest problem. Every single actor sucks and I hate them. Sarah Michelle Gellar is in this movie for 10 minutes, most of which she spends lying down. Everyone else is awful.
Why did you take me to that place? You wanted to come. What did I ever do to you?
The Grudge 2 basically flip-flops between the American story, the Japan story, and the definitely American school, but they want us to believe that it's in Japan story. Now dealing with an original plot, The Grudge 2 doubles down on the horror cliches and cheap scares. The opening begins with a bunch of cheap, ripped straight out of every single horror movie high schoolers going into the Sekai house. And, you know, you can already form what's going to happen in your head about what this scene is. Me showing you it would only confirm what you already know. The biggest addition that The Grudge 2 makes is also its worst.
First thing tomorrow morning, we have to go see her.
See who?
Kako's mother.
Let me break things down for you. Buffy's sister visits a Shinto shrine where Kayako's mother lives. It's revealed that Kayako's mother specialized in extracting evil spirits from people, and then fed them to her daughter. And this is the reason why Kayako went all spooky boogie. As if people weren't confusing Ju-on and the ring enough, we have to add in a stupid subplot about Kayako's mother. Not only that, but it cheapens things. Makes Kayako less scary. Shimizu may still be directing things, but he sure as hell ain't writing. Steven Susco. Susco? You see, that's not a Japanese name, so I don't feel bad when I mispronounce that. Is responsible for this mess. His previous screenwriting credits include The Grudge. But of course, 90% of The Grudge is just recycled from Ju-on. Earlier, when I said the original parts of The Grudge were the worst, The Grudge 2 is entirely original parts. And this is where you can tell there's a clear difference in writing quality. Kayako's violent death was enough of a reason to give her a vengeful return from the grave in Ju-on. The Grudge 2 needs to explain this further, needs to talk down to its audience. After explaining something enough, it ceases to be scary. There's no mystery left to it. It's something I see a lot, especially in American movies. This being dumbed down for some mass audience.
And I'm not gonna dumb it down for some bonehead mass audience! Not you!
And that's the real problem with The Grudge 2. It dumbed down the formula. And that would only continue with our next subject. Even a Ju-on movie at this point. The movie is told completely linearly from one point of view and takes place almost entirely in an American apartment. Do I even need to review this. The Grudge 3 returns to its roots by being a cheaply made horror movie. It strays from its roots entirely, however, by being absolute shit. This is a nothing movie. This is a movie where nothing happens for long stretches of time. Toshio and Kayako are just sort of there. They kill a few people, but they're barely in the film. I'm not just talking on-screen appearances, I'm talking them actually doing anything. Instead, The Grudge 3 focuses on a family of three, the youngest of which I was convinced was one of their daughters until about over an hour into the film where somebody offhandedly explains that they are all in fact siblings. The movie gets everything wrong about Ju-on. Every Ju-on segment was a slow burn to a chilling climax. This movie ditches that entirely and is just boring up until the climax where things actually start to happen on screen, but is still kind of drawn out and boring. The main character is your typical horror movie fodder that I was convinced would just be the first one to die until you realize she's actually the main character. Deanna Troi is in two scenes, giving everyone that next generation Ju-on crossover that they never knew they wanted.
Did you see anybody? Let's look under the bed. Okay, where else?
Is she there?
Is she behind here? Okay, where else? Is she behind here?
What about in the closet?
Okay. Maybe Isabella's gone home.
Anybody in here?
Let's see.
Screw that famous location that's been used in every movie east or west, the Saiki House is no longer the focus of The Grudge. Now instead, Kayako has made her home in one of the apartments from the last movie, which doesn't even make sense. But I'll get into that in just a bit. This, of course, draws the interest of a new character, Nanako. When she's introduced, I actually took some interest in the movie. She shows up in the first scene and takes place in Japan. She's going over all the different Grudge cases. And for a second, I thought, maybe this will be the one that's actually good, that actually stands on its own. I thought this character could be a Van Helsing to Kayako's Dracula. But
a husband killed his wife. An only child, Zen himself. The woman who was killed, she was my sister.
I lost all interest when it was revealed that this was Kayako's sister. I cannot begin to tell you how little interest I have in meeting any of Kayako's family members. I swear, if they ever make a Grudge 4, we're gonna meet Kayako's second cousin once removed. These are the least creative and least interesting plot developments in the whole franchise, and they completely cheapen the story of Kayako's death. Making Kayako evil to begin with neglects the actual horrible events that caused her and her son to do the spooky splash. Not only that, but the movie seems to completely forget how the curse works. Nanako is hunting down Kayako's appearances, but as we've seen in multiple Ju-on movies and The Grudge, Kayako can appear in multiple places at once. She's not strapped down to stay in America. You get the curse from entering the house, which doesn't appear at all in this movie, or you're interacting with somebody who has the curse. But this doesn't tether down Kayako to a new location. And even if it did, why this one specifically? The opening of the film takes place in an asylum. Why isn't she stuck there? They explain and recap the previous movies twice in this, just in case you didn't get it the first time. Once in the opening credits, which are just reused from the second film, and then again within the movie itself. If The Grudge 3 is not the peak of dumb for Ju-on, then I don't know how much more I can take. It's a low point. It's everything that the curse could have been if it was handled by a complete moron. And we still have four more Ju-ons to get through as we sail back east to the land of the rising sun.